So we have here 3x3 images, and that means we have shot within fisheye in three different directions, 120 degrees from each other in a horizontal orientation. And we have three different exposures each time, two stops apart from each other. And that could be also 9 or more, of course. What we want to do here is we want to create in one stop in PDGUI an HDRI panorama, or let's say MDRI, because we have only three stops. So I'm a little bit careful with that term. What we can do is track all the stuff directly in PDGUI. But for my taste, the white balance options in PDGUI are pretty rude, pretty rough. You can adjust this with numbers per channel. So that needs then a knowledge what you really want to do. What I prefer is to go to Camera Raw and adjust there some values. I select here all because I want to select all now to adjust the color temperature, and I have measured here 6500. I leave the tint out because I think I leave it neutral here. There was a lot of green in the area, and of course the gray card needs to be handled very carefully. It's not an absolute instrument. If I hold it here in the shadow, I get a different reading than directly in the sun or in a half shadow, or here close to the green boxes. Perfect, I get a green cast into it. So there's a lot of evaluation needed. There's not just a gray card hold into the scene and that's it. Example, when we have maybe here an orangey light from a sunset and we have the gray card in exactly that orange light, we would create then an white balance with this card, and it would take out all the orange color, and then it looks like daylight. So the whole sunset mood would be gone. So keep an eye on the gray card and what you had in the scene, what makes the most sense to you. Of course, to measure this with an Zirconic color meter is maybe preferable than any camera, because there's a lot of different stuff in it, to say it sloppily. So then we have here some darker values in the darker shots, of course. And as usual, darker images have more noise in it. And that is why I pick only these three, because we might want to have a look here at 100% at one and check out if we can maybe adjust here the noise reduction a little bit. And I wouldn't go here with the sharpening that high. You know me already. I'm not a friend of sharpening too early too much. So luminance maybe, but keep in mind, whatever you do here, you reduce the sharpness in the picture at itself. So noise out, blurriness in. That's the trade-off. There's no other way around. And that is why I keep that level here very low. But it's a mighty tool. When you have too much noise, it's really great. Anyway, so chromatic aberration here. We don't want to have any lens profile corrections here, but color. That could be something. And I check this here on. And then I go here with the spacebar down, because I know where the lens has its weak point normally, and that is in this area. But keep in mind, at the moment we have only selected three images. So I unselect this here, select all, and then I might select this here, and you might notice there is a little bit of fringiness here. And this is already a nice start point. You need to know what your fisheye lens does to the picture and how fringy it is, if you want to correct that at all. Because if you have these colors in your picture, this will be corrected to something else as well. So a dangerous field, but also very helpful. So if you have done now all of this, and I wouldn't do more, as you know me, for real values you do not touch any of these here or any of the curve here. You want to have the linear data exactly as it is from the camera. And that can be, of course, a little bit wrong. And gray cards or the Macbeth chart and with a individual color profile helps you, of course. But that is a little bit out of the scope from this tutorial. So having done all of this, everything is selected, I go then here and say save image. And I save everything here in Profoto, 16-bit, and in the size it has. And then I need here only to specify a name. Let's call it garden. and I give it here a number, 0.3. I have to select a folder, press save, and then it will save. When this is done, I come back to you with PTGUI open and I load these 9 pictures then in. So here I have my 9 TIFF files. And of course, I could have done this in one step from the RAW, but I would have missed everything that we have just adjusted. So I have to call up here PTGUI and my file browser here again. And I can drag this just into it. Otherwise, I would have to click here, load images and find them as well. Either way, we have to call up PTGUI here. And you see it loads relatively fast here. And the first thing that I normally suggest is, of course, have an eye on these values, 180 degree, that sounds okay. And we go then to the crop window here. And there we have here this circle. And this circle should go as close as possible to the usable data. I do not go to the blackened picture border. I see there's a little fringing here going on, so I always take that not into account by just excluding it here. Okay, so this should be all. And this is then done already for all in the same way. We don't have to do it for each picture because I have moved the lens or the camera or whatever, exchanged the camera even. So this works. And we have here from the tripod, of course, a little footprint. And we could mask this out, but we have not really something to fill it in. So this would be then something that we can do in Flaming Pear again, or directly in Body Paint 3D, of course, where we can have a projection on a sphere. And this ends already here the crop work, and we can go back to the project assistant and we click here just to align images. And then we get this question here, and we want to have an HDRI mode. And we want to link, of course, the bracketed images because we shot them from a tripod. So if we do not use this one, it will try to align them, which takes a longer time. So I use this. And if we have just shot roughly in the world with automatic on, then this here would be the right one. True HDRI, of course, even if it is an MDRI. And then it starts already to analyze everything. And we have cropped the image. So this round area here is roughly 50% only from our sensor size. And with the cropping, we give, of course, PTGUI the information, use only this part in the middle, but also don't care about anything else. And this is from the start what we get. The huge tripod here, because on the pole caps, everything looks a little bit bigger. And we have here these 3 images on top of each other. And I'll show you that to show that a little bit more clearly. This is one, this is the next one, and this is one as well. And we have here the different exposures, of course, then each time. So we can really see what's going on, if that fits on top of each other, or if we screwed up loading the wrong images on top of each other. Sounds good, looks good to me. And that means we can close this here. What I want to show, which is not really needed, is of course here the control points among all of these. Not so much, but you see again with the nice colorization, we have very fast an overview here and with these guys here as well. So let's hope for the best that everything works. And the preview showed me that. We do not have to fix here anything else. Perhaps we can go here to optimize now. And then we get here the vignetting curve, because the fisheye has a little bit, and the camera response curve, as you can see here. It's not over the whole picture in the same way. So everything is done. And we can go back to the project assistant or directly here to the create panorama. I have the habit to go here one time down and then end up here anyway. So we want to have all 9 pictures in it, 0 to 8, which means 9. And we want to have, of course, no tone map. That's not for 3D, not for information. And I think we can go here with the HDR panorama into the game. And if we need more, we render out more. OpenEXR is fine with me. And set optimum size. Again, this is in 360 by 180. You won't see a change here. if you have another panorama, that might change a lot, because when I go here, I can go always and track these yellow lines down, and that decreases the size here of these panels. It's on all four sides where this little icon shows up. So when you want to have only a part of it, you just drag it in and you get exactly only that area if you adjust this, of course, in the way here. Okay, no LDRI file. That would be nice as a preview, but I don't want to waste more time. And OpenEXR, everything is set. And so we can go create a panorama. So it starts with wrapping the image and then blending it, finding and so on. I'll come back when all is done. So, and here is the result in Photoshop, and the sky looks a little bit, I don't know, pale bluish. I'm not really happy with that. So let's have a look here to assign profile. And I guess we have the need for the pro photo, because that's sometimes stuff that PiDeGUI just ignores. And so you get an image without color profile, and then it takes the smallest possible sRGB, which is normally only for web use, or I don't know for what it is anyway. It's very small, very reduced. So Profoto is normally the one that gives you the colors back. And then we have here our floor area, and I leave this, of course, each time in. I could have shot it one time to the floor like I shoot up, and then we would have no problem. And sometimes we even tilt the fisheye a little bit up, so we have a nice pole cap here on the top and we have a big gap on the floor, because the floor is most of the time not really the one that has the most light energy, and we have to fix here the tripod in it. And my shadow was here inside of that tree or whatever that was, and I think it's nearly hidden. As a little side note, when you assign a profile to an OpenEXR file, it will be completely ignored when Photoshop writes OpenEXR out. And normally an OpenEXR should have just everything linearized. That means it doesn't even bother to have any color profile in it. And that's the problem, because the color profile that I just used to get my colors back from PiDeGUI will not survive this transport to Cinema 4D. The way out is, of course, to use Photoshop, because that can carry on this information. Or what you can do as well is to Command A, Command C to copy this. Then you go here to Edit, assign a profile because you can't convert it, and then go to Adobe RGB and say OK, and then Command V to get exactly what you have in your memory back into the picture, and then it converts everything here. So when I convert this now, then I have pretty much the colors that I expected to have, and then I can flatten it down. And when I save now my OpenEXR file, these colors will be relatively okay. Relatively, because there was already some conversions in it, and maybe Photoshop is here the better case, even if I like to work all the time with OpenEXR, but I haven't found a better workflow so far if I save my TIFF files with Profoto. And I have done this here, of course, to show you that there's always a little wiggle room in it when you have a workflow that is not possible from A to B. And OpenEXR with Photoshop is certainly one of the steps in it. How to fix this area we have seen already a couple of times, and also some other areas that are maybe not exactly in the way they should. However, this is now perfect for illumination, and it will have, of course, a spherical projection, or when you use a sphere primitive, you just can throw it on it, it will work, like the sky object will work. But keep in mind, the sky object, when you sit inside of a sphere, you have to flip the U tile to negative one to get this done. And again, this here has now 7,022 pixels. The other one with a 25 millimeter lens had 24,000 something, or 23,000 and something. So the file that we have here is now in width not even a third, and that means the whole area is maybe 10% of the other one, roughly said. That's of course a huge drop in pixel count, and for illumination purposes this is a wonderful solution because it is pretty fast and you can use HDRI in one step just out of PidiGui. But if you use this for reflections, we have discussed this, that might be suffer a little bit on some surfaces, not on all. Okay, thanks for listening. Have fun with it. Bye-bye.